Alhamdulillah, we reach Bab Salat al-Marid. Bab Salat al-Marid. The chapter on the prayer of the one who is ill or the one who is sick. Now, before we begin this chapter of Bab Salat al-Marid, as an introduction, it's important to point out that min rahmatillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa ihsan al-Sharia, and from the goodness of the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala min rahmatihi has made the Sharia, the laws and regulations and the ahkam, the ruling of al-Islam, mabniya, built upon an important principle. And that principle which the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is built upon is لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah does not burden a soul with more than he can bear. I'm going to see examples of this in this bab Salat al-Marid, in this chapter of the prayer of the one who is ill. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not burden a soul with more than it can bear. Therefore, based on this principle, the ulama have derived another principle, which I want you to write down bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, which is la wajiba ma'a al-ajzi or la wajiba ma'a adam al-qudra. There's no obligation with a lack of ability, or there's no obligations in the absence of ability. The reason I want you to write this down bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, that in this dars of fiqh, you're studying fiqh, that one of the important things you need to study is usul al-fiqh or qawa'id al-fiqhiyah, fundamentals or pillars of fiqh. Once you know these fundamentals, once you know these usul, these fundamentals, many of the different topic or issues that come up comes under these things, once you've memorized these things. And that's why they say, man jama'a lahu al-usul, jumi'a lahu al-usul. Whoever, by default, knows these usul, these pillars, these fundamental principles, all the other furu', all the other masail, automatically will become known to him. So the ulama, they say, la wajiba ma'al ajz. There is no obligation with inability. So this is on the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this obligation which Allah ta'ala has placed upon us, therefore means, if Allah has obligated you upon you something, to come with pillars, to come with conditions, if you don't have the ability to do it, you're not called to account for it. However, the takalif al-shari'iyya, the obligations of the Sharia, is not lifted in totality except with the lifting on one thing. And what is that thing? Mind. So long as your mind remains, your aql, your sanity remains, all the takalif, all the burdens or responsibility of the Sharia, we cannot say they're all lifted. So long as you have what? Sound mind. An example of this is the chapter we're in right now, which is Bab Salat al-Marid, to show the importance of a salah. That this salah is the most important pillar after the shahada of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That this is one of the issues. So long as your mind remains, the obligation of salah is still upon you. If you cannot move a single one of your limbs, even if you get to the stage whereby you cannot even blink, even if you get to a stage that you cannot even utter a word to yourself or even move your tongue, you pray with your heart. So the takalif al-sharia is never lifted completely except what? When one loses their mind completely. And there are three conditions or three states in which a person is considered not to be of sound mind. The first is that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, al-majnoon, the one who is majnoon, who is insane, hatta yafiq, until he gains his sanity. Al-na'im, the one who is sleeping, and these are very important because it's going to be affecting the issue of salah. The one who's sleeping, hatta yastayqidh, until he wakes up. Was-saghir, or the one that's young, until he reaches the age of maturity. So anybody who's in this state, or these three conditions, is not considered to be of full or sound mind. Full or sound mind. Or anybody who's similar to any of these three states, or share similarity with any of these states, these three states. So majnoon, so the one who's insane in Islam, if he became insane before maturity, look, he's mentally disabled, for example, and he reaches the age of maturity, whatever he does on purpose, intentionally, is counted as a what? A mistake. Wa min rahmatillah, from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is also from ahlu al-jannah, from the people of Jannah. If He has autism, for example, mental disability. He was born like that. And he goes into the age of maturity like this till he dies. It's from inshallah ta'ala, the people of Jannah, the people of paradise. So the takalif al-shari'iyya, they're not lifted completely except in any of those three states. So the mu'allif, rahimahullah ta'ala, began with this bab to also show us that the sharia of Allah Azza wa Jalla, if you don't have the ability to do something, it's not even upon you to look for that ability. For example, you don't have money for zakah. You don't have to look for the money for zakah now in order to pay what? Zakah. So long as you don't have it, you don't have to pay. So it began with bab salatul marid, the chapter on the salah of the marid, the one who's ill. So the mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala began by saying that mal marid idha kana al-qiyam yazidu fi maradihi salla jalisan. That the one who is ill, idha kana al-qiyam, if standing in salah increases him in his illness, salla jalisan, he prays sitting down. The first thing I want us to define is fi maradihi, is illness. They say laysa maradan khafifan, it's not a light illness or small illness. For example, somebody's got a runny nose or slight headache, so decide, you know what, I'm not feeling so good today, I'm going to pray sitting down. La maradan shadidan, severe or serious illness. Also he mentioned إِذَا كَانَ, if this increases him or increases his ailments or his sickness, he could pray sitting down. So this is the first condition, and this is the only condition which Mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala has mentioned here. If it increases his illness. And this condition is based on a principle of tib, a principle of medicine from the tib of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And one of the principles of medicines, and we mentioned, or the pillars of medicine are three. The first is hifdhu as-sihha, preservation of health. Preservation of health. And this comes in the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. Whoever amongst you is ill or is upon a journey could make up the fast at a later date. So the one who's traveling, for example, even though he has no sign of illness, jayid, he could still make up the fast at a later date. Why? حِفْظًا لِسِحَّتِهِ, to protect his well-being. Because on travel, on journeys, movement, and so on and so forth, you may become weak. So likewise, for the sake of preservation of health, if standing is going to increase his sickness, he's allowed to pray sitting down. Also, along the preservation of health, the ulama mentioned another condition, another guiding principle. إِنْ كَانَ يُؤَخِّرُ بُرْءُهُ, if praying standing up delays him getting better. If it delays him getting better, he's allowed to pray sitting down. Now these two things are related to what? Preservation of health. Meaning, if it affects him, makes it worse, or if it delays him getting better. It's related to what? Preservation of health. Now since it's related to preservation of health, what is the determining factor? Or who determines that it increases him in illness or it delays his getting better? A medical profession who is qualified and who is trustworthy. The ulama say it has to be a doctor, a qualified physician, that says that this only will get worse if you stand, or you not get better quickly if you keep standing in salah. Because qiyam, to stand in salah, ruknun, is a pillar from the pillars of salah. It's not something that you cannot do except with a valid excuse. So anybody who prays without standing, is salah is null and void. So these two conditions so far are related to what? Preservation of health. The ulama, they mention another condition. And this condition we mentioned in the very beginning of the class. Haytham, is it Haytham? Huh? Hashim, I always call it Haytham. Asif, ya. We mentioned in the beginning of the class that there's a second condition which is attached to everything. And what is that condition? Ya Hashim. We mentioned the very beginning of the class. What is that condition? Ya Qaisar. Huh? Barakallahu fi. There's no obligation without what? Al-ajz. With inability. So the other conditions the ulama mentioned here is what? Inability, al-ajz, or adam al-qudra. Lack of ability. Now, lack of ability when it comes to qiyam, to standing, for those taking notes, they said al-ajz no'an. There's two types of inability. Ajz al-kulli, complete inability. And the one who's completely unable to stand is the one, for example, who's paralyzed. He can't stand at all. Jayyid? Ajz al-kulli, complete inability. And the second type is ajz al-juz'i, partial inability to stand. And partial inability to stand means الَّذِي يَشُقُّ عَلَيْهِ الْقِيَامِ, the one that it is difficult for him to stand in salah. It is difficult, it causes him great difficulty. He can stand, but it causes him great difficulty. Now, this last thing here, the one that is difficult for him to stand, also needs some guiding principle. Now, how do we decide it's difficult for a person or for us to stand in salah? Because the rukun of salah. Maymun al-Mahran, he gave a guiding principle, which most of the scholars, they take. They say, and this principle is this, for the one that he finds it difficult, that is allowed not to stand in salah, إن استطاع أن يقوم لأمور دنياه وقضاء حوائجه لازم أن يقوم في الصلاة. If he could go around his daily affairs, his worldly affairs, standing and walking, and his day-to-day affairs, normally when it comes to salah, likewise he has to stand in what? In salah. This is a very important guiding principle. Because you find some people, for example, they're OAP, as we say in England, old age pensioners, that they've not retired from their work, and the whole day they're working, going about their daily business. But when it comes to salah, automatically, a default, I have to sit down. Or you find, as Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned, that in his time, there was a man in his 90s that used to teach young girls music, singing, dancing, with full energy and vigor. But when it came to salah, the same man would sit down when it comes to salah. Or even on the sister side, you find some of our elderly sisters, our mothers, they could go to a wedding, I don't know where they get the energy from, for hours they're clapping and singing and standing. But when it comes to tarawih or salah, automatically they sit down. So if he could go about his daily affairs standing, he should be able to stand in what? In a salah. This is the principle for the one who is partially unable. Some of the other ulama, they say, if standing, it affects his khushu', his concentration or tranquility in the salah. That true standing, although he can, is causing him a lack of concentration, is allowed not to stand in a salah. Therefore, al-qiyam, standing in salah, or not standing in salah, is only permitted if you are ill. With these conditions. And there are other times where it's permissible not to stand in other salawat. And what are these times? Which type of salah don't you have to stand in? Naam, nawafil, the voluntary salah. The voluntary salah, you don't have to stand. Any other time? The next, or the other time is something which is disagreed upon, but according to the most authentic opinion, it's also permissible. Which is, if you have an imam, and he prays sitting down, you should also pray sitting down. So these are the three times it's permissible to sit down praying. In illness, nafilah, and if the imam is sitting down. So he went on to mention the mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala. فَإِنْ لَمْ يَطِقْ فَعَلَى جَنْبِهِ. And if he's unable to pray standing, then عَلَى جَنْبِهِ, then upon his side. His side here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to hadith, which is going to mention later on, is not mentioned. Is it on his right side or on his left side? But that which is preferred, he prays on his right side, but it's not obligatory. He could also pray on his left side. And then, the mu'allif, rahimahullah ta'ala, said, لِقَوْلِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, based on the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Umran ibn Hussein, صَلِّ قَائِمًا, pray standing on, فَإِنْ لَمْ تَسْتَطِيعْ, if you cannot pray standing up, فَقَاعِدًا, pray sitting down. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَسْتَطِعْ, and if you cannot do so, فَعَلَى جَنْبِكْ, and upon your side. And then the mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala went on to mention, فَإِنْ شَقَّ عَلَيْهِ فَعَلَى ظَهْرِهِ, if it's difficult to pray on his side, then upon his what? Upon his back, lying down. He could pray lying down on his back. فَإِنْ عَجَزَ عَنِ الرُّكُوعِ وَالسُّجُودِ أَوْ مَأَى, and if it's difficult for him to go to ruku' or sujood, what does he do? He bows with his head. And he makes the bow for the head for the sujood longer or more lower than the one for a ruku'. Meaning, the whole salah, he prays it how? Standing. The whole salah, he prays standing. And when he wants to do ruku' or sujood, he does so with his what? With his head. Some other ulama, this is in the case of a person who cannot go to ruku' or sujood. Some of the other ulama, they say, if he is standing in salah, and due to his standing, he's not able to do, if he's standing in salah, but due to his standing, he cannot do ruku' or sujood, what should he do? They say he should pray sitting down. He should pray sitting down. If he cannot go from qiyam to sujood, but he could go from sitting to sujood, he should pray sitting down. Why? They say because the sujood, lubbu salah, is the heart of the salah itself. The sujood is the heart of the salah itself. And that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يَنْهَى. Do you not see the one that prevents? عَبْدًا إِذَا صَلَّى. The servant when he prays, Allah ta'ala say, كَلَّا لَا تُطِعْهُ وَاسْجُدْ وَاقْتَرِبْ. Do not obey. Make sujood and draw close. Because the closest you are to Allah is when you're in a state of what? A sujood. When you're in a state of sujood. So they say you should begin the prayer sitting down, because he will not be able to get up again. If he gets up, he will not be able to go to sujood. So if you could do sujood and ruku' and it means he doesn't stand up, he begins how? Just begins sitting down. Al-Qawl al-Rajih, the most authentic statement in all of this is the Qawl of the Jamhur, which is based on the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. Fear Allah to the best of your ability. And that is, he should begin the salah standing. Jayid, begin the salah in a state of standing. Then if he could go for sujood, go to sujood. If he could get up from sujood but he cannot go back to qiyam, he does what? He sits down. Jayid, he sits down through the rest of the prayer. However, if he could get up again, he gets up. And for some people, they can't go to ruku' and they have to sit down. So he could sit down for ruku' and he could sit down for a sujood if he has to sit down. So he fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best of ability. Now, most issue that comes up in this is, to what degree do I bow down in ruku' in sujood? All of this issue goes back to where? The heart. Because you're not living in ruku', you're not really in sujood, you intend with your heart. Another question is this, what if he cannot do any of that at all? What does he do? Some of the awwam, or the general people, they say, he uses his what? He can't move his head, for example. He uses his finger. Ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah ta'ala, say, هذا من فتاوى الأبواب. This is from the fatawa of the common men, that they say uses his finger. He said there's no such thing. There's no delete of fingers at all. But rather, what he should do is to pray with his what? His heart. That when he's praying, he's intending ruku' with sujood with his what? With his heart. So he finds some people, for example, that are really, really ill. They cannot be turned towards the qibla. They cannot purify themselves, but the obligation of salah is never lifted. The obligation is that even if he has to pray with his heart, he just prays with his heart. The obligation under any circumstance is not lifted so long as he's got what? Aql, his mind. So long as the mind is there, he still has to pray. So the Mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala went on to mention, وَعَلَيْهِ قَضَى مَا فَاتَهُ مِنَ الصَّلَوَاتِ فِي إِغْمَائِهِ. And upon him is to make up what he has missed from the prayers fi إِغْمَائِهِ, while he was in a state of unconsciousness. Because some people are ill, they become unconscious, or they go into a coma. So the madhab here from that which is apparent is, anybody who is in a state of unconsciousness, like coma for example, they have to make up the what? The salah when they come out of a coma. So you find some people, they are in a coma for, let's say, 3 months. That means they have to make up the salah for the previous 3 months they were in a coma. However, on this issue, there's ikhtilaf amongst the ulama. 3 different opinions. The first opinion is that which I mentioned, which is the madhab Imam Ahmad. That they have to make up the salah. Jayid? The second opinion is an opinion that they make up the salah in kanat al-mudda if the time of their coma or unconsciousness was a short period. Some say a day, 24 hours, and some say 3 days. Anything between a day and 3 days. And the third opinion is, it doesn't have to make up any of it. So we're going to look at the evidence of each and every single group of scholars. As for the first group of scholars, they say, he must make up the salah لِأَنَّ الْمُغْمَ عَلَيْكَ النَّائِمُ. The one who's unconscious or in a state of unconsciousness is similar to the one who's in a state of what? Sleep. And if you're sleeping and you wake up, you have to make up all the salawat. Jayyid, you have to make it up. Whenever you remember you wake up, you have to make it up. So the one who's in a state of unconsciousness is just like the one who's a what? Who's asleep. So in the same way he has to make it up, he also has to make it up. And we have the situation of Ammar ibn Yasir radiallahu anhu, in which he was unconscious for 3 days. And he woke up after 3 days, or he came around after 3 days, and he made up the salah of 3 days. The second group of scholars, they say, yes, you are correct. In that, the one who is unconscious is similar to the one who is sleeping. However though, that comparison and that similarity only applies if the norms are the same, they're similar. And the norm for a person who sleeps is 24 hours. It could be 5 days salah. But it's very unusual for someone to sleep for 2 days. And if it increases, maybe 3 days. Somebody slept for 3 days in a row. So therefore, if you're going to compare the two, the norm is a day or 3 days. Anything which is above 3 days is out of the what? The norm. So we could no longer compare him to a person who's what? Sleeping. So if it's 3 days or a day, he makes it up. The last group of scholars who say he doesn't have to make it up, they say he doesn't have to make it up except if he comes around at the time of any other two salah. So for example, he passed it at the time of Dhuhr. And he comes back around at the time of Dhuhr. He prays Dhuhr. If he passes at the time of Dhuhr, he comes around at the time of Asr. He prays Dhuhr and Asr. And they say their evidence is the analogy of comparing somebody who's asleep to somebody who's unconscious, qiyasun ma al-fariq. These are two dissimilar situations. Because the one who's sleeping, you could wake him up or you push him, okay, he'll get up. But the one who's mugma alay, you cannot wake him up. But although in both instances, it's connected to what? The absence of mind. But we know the absence of mind is not only due to sleep. Absence of mind could also be due to what? Insanity. So they say the one who's in a state of unconsciousness, إِلَى الْمَجْنُونَ أَقْرَبُ, is actually closer in analogy to the one who's what? Who's lost his mind. So therefore, they say you do not have to make it up. And the most authentic opinion, Allahu Ta'ala A'alam, and Allah Ta'ala knows best, is he doesn't have to make up the salah, except if he comes around during the time of the two prayers. That's when he makes it up. But to be cautious, on the safe side, if somebody wants to make it up for 3 days, they can do so. Just to be cautious, on the same side, safe side. But they don't have to do this. So, عَلَيْهِ قَضَى مِنَ الصَّلَوَاتِ إِغْمَائِهِ وَإِنْ شَقَّ عَلَيْهِ فِعْلُ كُلِّ الصَّلَاةِ فِي وَقْتِهَا. And if it is difficult for him to do the salawat at the time or the specific time, فَلَهُ الْجَمْعُ, is allowed to do a jam' بَيْنَ الظُّهُرُ وَالْعَصْرُ بَيْنَ عِشَاءَيْنِ فِي وَقْتِ إِحْدَاهُمَا. Is allowed to join the salah of Dhuhr and Asr and Isha'ain, Maghrib and Isha at any of the two times. So here is going on to the mas'ala of al-jam'u, joining the prayers. Now, majority of the scholars, the Madhab and Malik, Imam Ahmad, they're of the opinion that it's permissible to join salah due to difficulty. Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala, is not of this opinion. However, the opinion of Imam Ahmad, Imam Malik, the Jamhur is the correct opinion. Because in accordance to the what? The Sunnah. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina, he joined between Dhuhr and Asr. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said, أَرَادَ أَلَّا يُحَرِّجْ أُمَّتَهُ. He didn't want to make things difficult for his Ummah. The Rahmah of the Deen al-Islam, that he could join between the Salah. Then he went on to say, because we have two types of joining. We have a jam'u wa taqdeen wa jam'u wa ta'khir. Joining and advancing the time of the next prayer. Meaning you join and you advance one of the prayers. So for example, you join Dhuhr and Asr at the time of Dhuhr. You've advanced it. And there's jam'u wa ta'khir, which is to join and delay one of them. So for example, you join Maghrib and Isha. You pray Maghrib at the time of Isha. Now it's going to give the conditions for both. He said, as for jam'u wa taqdeen, فَإِنْ جَمْعَ وَقْتَ الْأُولَى. If he does jam'u wa taqdeen, meaning he prays Dhuhr and Asr at the time of Dhuhr, يُشْتَرَطْ or أُشْتُرِطَ نِيَّةُ الْجَمْعِ. He has to have the intention for combining. Meaning if when he makes takbir, ihram for Dhuhr, Allahu Akbar, If you have the intention, he's going to join it with asr. This is the first condition. The second condition is يُعْتَبَرْ إِسْتِمْرَارَ الْعُذْرِ حَتَّى يَشْرَعْ فِي الثَّانِيَةِ. The excuse for which he's joined the prayer with, which is illness, should still be continuing. And the last condition is there should not be a long period of time between joining between the two prayers. Jayyid. And the time period he gives is the time period it would take someone to normally do al-wudu. What are the evidence for the three conditions? The first condition of niyyah. There's no evidence from the Quran or the Sunnah at all. In fact, it's contrary to the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it in Medina, he didn't tell the Sahaba he intended to do this, the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Nor did he tell the Sahaba to do what? Make intention to join at the time of what? Al-Dhuhr. So there's no evidence for this. So this evidence, there's no evidence for it at all. And this is also applicable when it comes to travel. If you're traveling and you pray Dhuhr, and the Prophet said, you know what, should we just pray Asr now? And you didn't make intention to pray Asr, you could still pray. It's not a condition you have intention from before. Jayyid. And this is also applicable in Matar, when it comes to the rain. Sometimes it rains at Maghrib, and then people come to the masjid, it's raining, and people turn, the Imam turns around after giving taslim, and people say, what do you think? Should we just pray Isha now instead of coming back again? And people say, okay, let's pray Isha. Even though they didn't have the intention before, it's permissible to do so. So this first condition, there's no delay. The second condition, it says, istimrar al-udhur. The validity of the excuse must still be there. Meaning, if you're feeling very ill at the time of Dhuhr, you made takbirat ihram, you prayed Dhuhr. And then, you want to now begin to pray Asr at the time of Dhuhr. If the illness is gone, khalas, you cannot continue. You cannot do what? A jam'. You can't combine the salah. And this is a very important mas'ala when it comes to traveling. Sometimes people travel, they expect to get to where they're going, let's say, for example, by Maghrib. Jayyid? Or by Asr, for example. Let's say I'm going from Makkah to Riyadh. I assume I'm going to get there by Asr. So now, I get there, not at Asr, I get the time of Dhuhr. Jayyid? I had the intention to combine my Salah. What do I do now when I pray Dhuhr? Can I still combine? No. If I'm a resident of Riyadh, I can't combine. Why? Because the Udhur, the excuse for combining is gone. I'm no longer a traveler. And sometimes this happens to us, that we're traveling, we expect to get where we're going by Isha. But we get there by Maghrib. So now because we come from a journey, what do we end up doing? We pray Maghrib and we pray Isha. La. The excuse to join now is gone. You're no longer a traveler. Jayyid? So the issue of istimrar al-udhur, the excuse has to continue. And last condition it mentioned is, there shouldn't be a long time period. The time it will take somebody to make wudu. This also has no evidence from the Quran or the Sunnah. In fact, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Arafah, after praying Maghrib, he told the Sahaba to unload their goods from their camels. And the time of unloading and so on and so forth, and unpacking, it was quite a considerable period of time. Then after that, they prayed Isha. They prayed Isha. So they say, حُكْمُ الْوَقْتَيْنِ فِي حَقِّهِ. The ruling of the two times of Salah, concerning the one who was ill, was traveling, is that the ruling of what? One period, one time. Meaning, the time of Dhuhr and Asr, which are two different periods, the time for the one who's traveling, who's ill, is the similar thing to what? One time. So if you pray Dhuhr at the time of Dhuhr, and you wait for an hour, 1 hour, 2 hours later, and you pray Asr, at the time of Dhuhr still, is one time. It's considered to be one time. So there's no evidence for this. So the only thing which we're agreeing is what? The continuation of the excuse. Then after that, he went on to mention that if he wants to, for in Jama'ah, Safwan, if he wants to continue, he wants to join between the two by delaying it to the time of the next prayer, the excuse for what he's delayed it for should still be present at the time of the next prayer. So he's delayed the Salah till Asr. So long as he's ill, he could delay it till Asr. We agree with this condition. The second condition, and yanwi al-jam' fi waqti al-ula qabla an yadhiq an fi'liha. He has to make the intention to join the Dhuhr with al-Asr at the time of what? At the time of Dhuhr. Why? Because delaying the Salah to a point where it's almost out without an excuse is not acceptable. So if he knows he's going to pray the Asr, he has to have made this intention. He doesn't wait till Dhuhr is almost out and say, you know what, I'm going to pray Asr time. Because haram, it's not permissible to delay your salah. This is the other condition. So he mentioned two conditions. Then he went on to say, وَيَجُوزَ الْجَمْعُ, the other times which is permissible for a person to combine the salah, لِلْمُسَافِرُ, for the one who is on a journey. Ahlul Ra'i and some of the ulama, they say al-jam'u, combining the salah, there has to be mashaqqa. There has to be an aspect of difficulty or hardship. And I think this is the madhab of the Ahnaf likewise. And mashaqqa, hardship, is you should be on the journey. For example, we're traveling from here to Masa'id, for example. We're in the car, we stop at a petrol station, Maghrib time, we join the Salah. We continue, say, inshallah ta'ala, when the border opens up, we're going for Umrah. We stop at another petrol station. We could keep combining the Salah because we're upon the journey. They say the mashaqqa is the journey itself. But let's say, for example, now we reach Riyadh. We're still travelers because we're not from there. If we're not upon the journey, we're in a hotel for 2-3 days, the opinion of those group of scholars is the mashaqqa, the hardship is gone. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never did it except in Muzdalifah and Arafah. So therefore, you should not be combining your salah except it's on the journey and there's a hardship. The other group of scholars say, na'am, this is the sunnah, but it's not an obligation. It's not a condition to make it permissible to join your salah. So even if you're settled, you're resident, not a resident, you're settled in a hotel in Riyadh, you could still continue to join your prayers. Wallahu ta'ala a'alam, this is the most authentic opinion, that even if you're not on a journey, a jam'u is permissible. To join between the salah is permissible. And based on this, jamhur al-ulama, they have a principle. And that principle, for those of you taking notes, is mata jaza al-qasr jaza al-jam'u. Whenever it is permitted for you, or you have the rukhsa to do qasr, to shorten your prayers, by automatic default, you're also allowed to do what? Join your prayers. Because the group of scholars that say you cannot join it, they say you could do what? You could shorten it. But the jamhur ulama, they say at any time that you could shorten your prayers, automatically by default, you could also do what? Join your prayers. So the principle is whenever it is permissible to shorten, it is permissible to what? To also join the salah, to join the prayers. Then he mentioned wal-matar, and also during the time when it rains. Now the issue of raining, the ulama, they put condition for the issue of rain. Is it any rain that rains? They put the same condition for the one who cannot stand that. So long as it doesn't affect people's daily affairs, their worldly affairs. For example, it rains, just a light drizzle, people are still going about their normal business. Jayyid, is not an excuse not to do what? It's not an excuse to join the salah, because things are still continuing as normal. For example, for some of us, so let's say for example, from England, for example, we have drizzles, light showers, and things just go on as normal. You know, great old England, as they say. You know, we still go to salah at the time of salawat, we don't join the prayers, because it's not difficult, the transport, the drainage system, it doesn't cause any difficulty for us. There's lamps, there's no mud, in that, so it's not every single rain that rains, I say, you know what, it's rain, let's join our salah. La. If there's a difficulty in doing so. And that difficulty, the way they measure the difficulty is, number one, if it causes difficulty for you, people going about their normal business, such as it wets your clothes, you know, yeah, your clothes become severely wet, or there's a lot of cold, a lot of wind and mud, jayid, those are the kind of difficulties that makes it permissible for you to join your salah when it is raining. Some of the other ulama, they say the rukhsa, the permission to join the salah, is only in Maghrib and Isha. Because the purpose of joining the salah, they say, is the road is slippery, it is cold, and the time that is cold, the road is slippery, you can't usually see where you're going very well. Is at what time? The time of what? Maghrib and Isha. That when it's raining severely, it's only at those times, Maghrib and Isha, you could join your salah. The other ulama, they say no. So long as the excuse or the permission remains, which is rain in itself, anytime you could join. For the Dhuhr and Asr, you could also join. So long as the udhr, the excuse is there, which is severe rain, your clothes become wet. For example, when it rains in Saudi Arabia, forget Maghrib Isha. When I was there, even at Doha, nobody goes out in some of the rains because of the drainage system. People die in those rains. So whenever it is difficult, whether it's Maghrib and Isha, Dhuhr and Asr, so long as that excuse remains and those guidelines are there, you pray and you could join. But the sunnah, however, is if you have such a rain, that the mu'adhin, after making the adhan, should say, Sallu fi rihalikum. Sallu fi rihalikum. Pray in your houses, pray in your houses. Now for those who come to the masjid and they pray in their house, if the imam joins between Maghrib and Isha, they don't pray Maghrib and say, you know what, I'm going to go and pray Isha at home. They should also join him and pray with him. Maghrib and Isha. No one should say, you know what, I don't want to join, I'm going to go home and pray. Jayyid, they should pray with him Maghrib and Isha in al-Jama'ah. But in the first place, the sunnah should be, the mu'adhin should say, Sallu fi rihalikum. Pray in your houses. And I've been in conditions in Africa, even at time of Dhuhr or Asr, when it rains severely, it's too dangerous to go out. Too dangerous. Also, the sunnah of traveling. We mentioned you could join between your salah. There's an important aspect of the sunnah as well. That the sunnah is, and that which is better, to pray at the time of every single salah, but you're allowed to join it. Also, the sunnah is, for those who are traveling, if you're traveling between the, before the time of Zawal, before Ad-Dhuhr, the sunnah is to delay your salah till Asr. But if Dhuhr ba'd al-Zawal has come in, the sunnah is to pray your Dhuhr, Asr, and leave. And pray your Dhuhr and Asr. Jayyid? If you're traveling, قبل غروب الشمس, before the sunset, the sunnah is to delay all the way to what? Isha. Jayyid? This is the sunnah in these issues. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. We'll stop here for today, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. And next week we'll continue with Bab Salat al-Musafir, the chapter on the Salah of the Musafir, the traveler. Any questions? Naam.